Good evening to everyone. As the head of the Department of Chemistry, University of Peradeniya, I am pleased to welcome all of you to the ninth webinar of INSPIRE series conducted by our department. Today's INSPIRE webinar is kind of special to all of us, as today is the first day a lady professor addresses the INSPIRE gathering as the invited speaker. The other thing is that the invited speaker is not a visitor to us, as she was also a very precise product from our chemistry department at Peradeniya. Therefore, Professor Nilvala Kotegoda, you could also be proud of being the lady who got the first chance to address the INSPIRE webinar of your alma mater. So I am sure this lecture will be a very fruitful one for everyone. So without taking much time, I would like to invite Madam Chandani to introduce Professor Nilvala Kotegoda to the audience. So have a pleasant evening. It's over to you, Madam Chandani.
Okay. Good evening to everyone. It's my great pleasure to introduce our guest speaker today, the first lady speaker in our INSPIRE webinar series, as our head of the department mentioned, and a very special lady scientist, Professor Nilvala Kotegoda, head of the Department of Chemistry, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. So why I introduce her as a very special lady scientist is that she is the science advisor to His Excellency, the President of the Democratic Socialist Republic of Sri Lanka. We are really proud of you, Nilvala, for being a product of the Peradeniya Chemistry Department and being able to serve in such a high caliber position. Professor Nilvala Kotegoda obtained her BSc special degree in chemistry with a first class honors from the University of Peradeniya in the year 2000. She was recruited to the Department of Chemistry in the same year and subsequently got admission to the University of Cambridge in UK to pursue her graduate studies in the field of material chemistry under the supervision of Professor W. Johns. After obtaining her PhD in in 2007. There, she was appointed as the head of the chemistry department in 2019, and she is still serving as the head of the department. Up to date, she has done a remarkable contribution to research at both national and international levels. She has held influential administrative positions in the Sri Lanka Institute of Nanotechnology, that is SLINTEC, since its inception. At SLINTEC, she has worked as a senior research scientist, analytical services manager, senior research consultant, and also as the principal scientist and the first provost of the SLINTEC Academy. She has also served as the director of the Center for Advanced Materials Research in the University of Sri Jayawardenepura from 2015 to 2018. Professor Kotegoda has over 15 years of teaching experience in material science, nanotechnology, physical chemistry, and also polymer chemistry. She has extensive research experience in nanotechnology. Some of them are nanomaterial synthesis and characterization, development of nano delivery systems for nutraceuticals and plant nutrients, polymer nanocomposites, water purification based on nanotechnology, and value addition to natural resources. She has published more than 50 peer-reviewed research papers in high-impact journals, contributed to writing book chapters, innovations, and she also published a significant number of papers. Professor Kotegoda has received many local and international awards for her outstanding research outputs. She has also received many local and foreign research grants and is carrying out many innovative research projects targeting commercialization and value addition to local raw materials. Today, she is going to share her expertise and insights into the fascinating innovations she made throughout her academic journey, starting from basic sciences to nanotechnology, through the today's topic, Bricks of Innovations to Rebuild the Lost Paradise. President Ilvala, we are grateful to you for accepting our invitation and agreeing to spend your valuable time with us in this evening. I hope all our participants will get an exceptional motivation and join hands to rebuild the lost paradise after listening to this webinar today. So without taking much of your time, I cordially invite President Ilvala to start the webinar. It's over to you, President Ilvala.
She's muted. Okay.
Yeah, you have to unmute the thing.
Sorry about it. Good evening. And thank you very much, Madam Chandani. Today is a very special day in my life. I felt that I have returned my home after 15 years. And actually my heart beats faster. And I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to the organizers of this webinar series and for inviting me to this very special occasion. Thank you very much. Before starting, I would like to dedicate my talk to late Dr. Tilak Thenakorn. Sometimes in your life, only if you are really blessed and lucky, you will meet a mentor who will transfigure your career. Support through every little step in reaching the apogee, dear sir, for me, you were that greatest mentor who elevated, uplifted, and reshaped my career. If I have gained any success today, I owe most of it to you, sir. We miss you. So they taught me to manipulate the matter back in 2000. So this was my mentors, my living gods in this world. So I fondly, these great mentors actually laid the first set of innovation bricks in my life, in my lifelong chemistry career. So I very fondly remember them today. Before I start this lecture, I miss Professor Dias. I couldn't find his photo. And also I gather the memories of Professor Vannigama, late Professor Vannigama at this very special location. So my journey of creating new knowledge, I started at this beautiful department, Department of Chemistry, University of Peradeniya. I know that this is the country's most celebrated chemistry department, which have produced many of the eminent scientists. And also I'm actually honored to be emerged from this department. So this is the cradle of my career. And also, I would like to really extend my gratitude to my very first person who laid the brick of research in my life, Professor Chandani. She laid the first brick of innovation in my life. I am honored to see today she is one of the topmost women scientists. I would say she's an iron woman in the country with, I think she has the highest number. She's one of the highest cited scientists too. So she's one of my pioneering teachers from Peradeniya. Thank you, madam. I am here because of you. And then actually, I am also, after carrying out my initial degree at Peradeniya, I was lucky enough to get admitted to one of the leading chemistry departments in the University of Cambridge. So I would like to note here, again, Professor Tennakoon was the person behind my journey there. He gave me all the encouragement to enter this department, and I really fondly remember Professor Bill Jones, who was my research supervisor. Actually, Professor Jones made a big difference to my career. It was one of the turning points. He was a very different supervisor. He never followed up my work. On the very first day, when I entered this department, it was a very warm welcome with the coffee evening. So he gave me all kind of introduction, but I was eagerly waiting for him to give me a project. Instead, he said, "You are going, so I am working on layered materials and I am interested in exfoliation." That's it. So two words, layered materials and exfoliation, the two words that transformed my life. So I had to find out what is my research title. I had to find out where are the labs. I had to find out how to come out of this deep end of the pool. I was really lost at that point, but later on, I turned out to be a very strong personality because of this, the style of supervision and the opportunities he gave me behind the screen. He never guided me, I would say, but he was always there to facilitate me. So thank you very much, Bill, again. So he gave me a lot of lessons for my career. So soon after my PhD, I returned back to Peradeniya, and for certain matters, I had to come to my next home, Department of Chemistry, University of Sri Davanagere, where I started my new career, new lease of life. And so after joining Jayawardhanapura, a very specific thing happened. That is, the country, Sri Lanka, that time there was a proposal coming up to set up a advanced technological park, because Sri Lanka never had even an idea of establishing advanced technological park. But that was the time the scientists realized the need for transforming our economy, which I will talk a little later about it. So there, that is where I started my research career, or it was again a turning point. And definitely Jayawardhanapura facilitated all my research, and finally, my career was further enhanced by the opportunity that I got to work at Rice University as a Fulbright Fellow. So before I get into the other stuff, I would like to change my topic a little bit. The world is moving at a rapid pace. So it's the technology is changing very rapidly. So all the countries are working towards various advancements. Now, did you know that the pandemic, we all are talking about pandemic. Pandemic has made a major turning point in the scientific history. Did you ever think this was an opportunity for a group of scientists in this planet? It was actually. The COVID-19 vaccine was one of the fastest delivered vaccine in the history. So thanks to the new technology, thanks to the nanotechnology, the hero in this story is a little lipid nanoparticles. Until that time, the scientists, the drug industry was suffering of a delivery mechanism, because DNA or mRNA cannot be delivered to the target without destroying, or you can't do an efficient delivery without a nanoparticle. So this is the hero of this story. So world is moving fast, and also we can see people are creating the nature in the lab. We know we are getting old and old, so our organs get expired, and if your kidneys expired, somebody will donate you a kidney and you will transplant it. But today scientists are looking at very advanced methods of living longer. So now the printing of organs, this is one big area of research again. And also transforming the next generation fashion trends, the textiles. So if you look at the textile industry, wearable electronics, smart textiles are taking the priority in the technological developments. So why I wanted to highlight this next generation technologies is that to highlight where we are today. So the future is different. Future will be very different. If there are any students in this audience, you have to realize the jobs that you will be doing in the future would be completely new types. So it won't be the traditional jobs with these big changes in the technology. So you have to think of yourself to be relevant when time to come. So you have to plan your future in a way that you are relevant with this rapidly moving technologies. But I'd like to talk about the situation in Sri Lanka. So I start from the history. I want to join this dots to the global trends actually. So we had a glorious history, glorious days. Looking into the past, we saw that the wind-powered iron smelting technology was invented in Sri Lanka. Damascus swords, which uses the nanotechnology, was invented in Sri Lanka. We knew that we were the granary of the ancient East. And medical history, medical systems, and most importantly, water technology. Globally, water is a major issue. There are water-related problems today. So scientists are looking at the new technologies for water problems. But remember, we had the best water technology in Sri Lanka. But what are we doing today? If you look at Sri Lanka, we have the world's best resources, including the human resources. All resources are globally first, but it is so unfortunate that we are on the voyage of collapsing. The Sri Lankan economy is collapsing, unfortunate. Today, we are the only country where highest cost to obtain a liter of purified water, highest per capita expenditure on food, and 50% of the agricultural production is lost in this country. We are the only country exporting raw minerals, agro-based products without any value addition. In summary, we have only 1.02% of high-tech import, the income from high-tech manufacturing, which is really, really unfortunate situation for a country like Sri Lanka. This picture tells you the story. You can see on your top left-hand corner, the Sri Lankan graphite industry in 1910, and right bottom-hand corner, it is the industry today. So we are putting in gunny bags. It's a gunny bag export economy. So we, after 100 years, we are still stuck in the gunny bag exporting economy. So in another 100 years, if it continues, the next generation will repeat the same slide. The my dear students, researchers, please understand, we shouldn't allow our next generation to repeat this slide. So we have to connect the dots and search for solutions. In other words, it's time to move from resource-based economy to a knowledge-based economy. So this is the transformation that we expect. We need the bricks of innovation. So we lost our paradise some time back. Now it's the time to recreate it. We cannot recreate it until we change ourselves. So beyond the pearl of the Indian Ocean, global trends, 12 economically disruptive technologies have been identified, where technologies such as advanced materials and the IoT, Internet of Things, these are very relevant to our country. We have the capacity to contribute to the next generation of technology through this. So we have all resources. So let's see, how could we shift this gunny bag economy to a high-tech exports? So tool is technology, the transformation. So turning point in my career, as I said at the very beginning, was joining SlimTech as a very young researcher back in 2008. But by the time I joined this mega project, the script was written by pioneer scientists. I'm very proud to see Professor Rajapaksha was one of, Professor Rajapaksha from Peradeniya was one of the leading scientists who drive this project to convince the government and the private sector to come up with the new concept of having an advanced technology park. So we started from a garage of a company owned by Mars Holdings. We went to an empty room. From there, we didn't know how to build up. A few scientists who had the training in advanced technology was handpicked together with three giant characters. So they were pillars of strength to me. And I started my journey at SlimTech with these three pillars, Professor Gihan Amaratunga, Professor Aditya Alvis, and Professor Veranja Karunaratna. I'm proud he's from Peradeniya again. We have been working for the last 25 years. I note that he's the highest cited chemist in the country today. I'm very honored to be guided and mentored by you, sir. If you are in the audience, a very big thank to you. And here we start our journey. From that garage, today we are in this global standard lab. We have all facilities needed to carry out advanced technology, advanced research. So all young scientists, there is an opportunity in this building. And not only that, it is not just the one building today, it is a technology park. If you visit Tomagama, you can see this beautiful place. Actually, I'm very honored to be founding member of this team and write this entire story of building an advanced technology and innovation culture for Sri Lanka for the next generation. So would like to shift towards my research career, some of my pioneering and revolutionary, I would say, the research that reached the global standard. Would like to talk a little bit. In 2009, as a senior scientist, while working on building this very special institute, I was given the task of coming up with an advanced plant nutrient formulation which could efficiently deliver nutrient to a plant. So the first step to do was, we had to come up with an innovation. So the first step was, if you are starting a new research, the first step is to look for the patent literature. And we found that advanced technology, especially nanotechnology based, there were only 400 patents in the US patent office on agriculture-based innovations, while there were over 6,000 patents in the pharmaceutical innovations. So we realized, we had a team, and we realized that we have plenty of room in this area. So we took the challenge. It was really challenging because it was a global problem. Because when you use fertilizer, 70%, 50 to 70% of the fertilizer is lost to the environment and to the groundwater table. Plant absorbs only 30%, which was a major issue. So if we could come up with the new system where this fertilizer becomes slow release, it was one of the hits in the innovation arena. So our mandate was to come up with the formulation which has an economic importance too. By that time, Sri Lanka has understood the importance of advanced technologies. Or as I said, we had the mandate of increasing that 1% income to a higher percentage. So we did the numbers. These are the numbers when we started our project, and we realized if you save 10% of the urea fertilizer that is imported to the country, we save $44 million, and we minimize major environmental effects. So we had some claim. I mean, it was an opportunity for the team. So we thought that change has an economic value. Again, moving on to my fundamental chemistry. So whole project was drawn through the fundamentals of chemistry. So it's very important that we apply our fundamental knowledge to all the applied projects. So we went to our fundamentals. My high school teacher, my undergraduate chemistry teachers, they taught me that there can be high specific type of van der Waals bonds, which is hydrogen bonding, which is not too strong or too weak. So we thought if we can combine this fertilizer to a nanoparticle through a hydrogen bond, that would give a smart releasing system where we selected a very specific nanoparticle, hydroxyapatite, which is biocompatible, which is in your bone, so which is in epavalent of phosphate. So it is already in use, the main constituent, but we converted it into a nanoparticle. And then we were able to anchor the urea molecules because of the rich chemistry of the hydroxyapatite nanoparticles allowed to anchor molecules like urea onto the surface through hydrogen bonding network. So the system was not releasing the nutrients at a very fast rate, nor it released in a very slow rate that the plant doesn't get it. So that was our system one. We developed several systems on this, and based on this, we went to a second system. This is how our hydroxyapatite nanoparticles look like. And the good thing is we were able to come close to the nitrogen percentage in urea. We were able to load 40% of the nitrogen thanks to the high surface area offered by the nanoparticles of hydroxyapatite. And same time, we were able to deliver phosphorus nutrient into the plants as well. So not stopping at that point, we came up with the second system, which is very, very biocompatible. And there what we did, we took the stems of the Glycyrrhiza plant, which had the cavities. The cavities were about 60% of the stem was free space. So we loaded this system into these cavities and we made the wood chip. And we put this wood chip into the plant. With the biodegradation of the wood chip, the plant gets both the organic matter and also the two plant nutrients. So this was our second system, and we had a third system where we encapsulated this whole system into a clay material. Clays are again very biocompatible. It's already in the environment. So we put this system in between the galleries of a clay. So which gave us very significantly slow releasing fertilizer systems, leading to four new innovations. So we were able to secure four patents for this particular innovation, and we didn't stop there. Remember, if you are to contribute towards the economic development of the country, the test tube chemistry is not sufficient. You have to understand it should be able to be used by the society. We should serve our poor people. So what we did, we scaled up the production and we did the field trials and we proved our system within the farmers' field. And you can see these were some of our patents. And good thing was the search report coming from the patent office said that this is globally first. We didn't have many of his actions. So it was a very straightforward innovation, but done with a team of scientists at Swintech. However, after getting the patents, we were in a very difficult situation. You may know that getting a patent, or especially in US or in another country, is really money consuming. It's very costly. So we had to spend a lot, and we got the blame saying that your patent does not work, at least the 4A4 papers that you have written on me. So we were really discouraged as a team. The whole team was looking for alternatives. As scientists, our next approach is always to publish our work. As scientists, we always love to publish. Our first paper was a milestone because it got 10 rejections. Some days I used to upload the paper in the office and come home. Before I come home, the paper is rejected. No one wanted to believe that Sri Lanka has done some significant work. So it was very difficult to penetrate into the publishing area. But this was a very lucky event for us, then we published it in a low index journal, which was a lucky event for the team. And however, later on, we were able to move our publication to very high index journals like ACS Nano 2. So as I said, our first paper was a milestone to Sri Lankan history, because this paper was picked up by one Indian fertilizer manufacturing company, and they wanted to borrow our technology. They wanted to purchase our technology and use it in India for commercialization. So after several negotiations, we had to agree to give our technology to this company, because you know, even in US, 30% of the income is through technology transfer. So there is no harm if you do it in the correct way. However, we did the technology transfer, and this is the scaled up plant, and this is our final product. You can see at the top end of the slide. So that is our product, which we made in kilogram quantities, like 100 kilograms a day. And however, the commercialization is still pending even with this company. And then my next second baby, that my loving project, is that value addition to natural minerals in Sri Lanka, the mineral value addition. So this was a fascinating area to me. The curiosity arose when I was an undergraduate. Especially, this section was taught by Professor Ile Peruma. He made us thinking. He used to tell this story that Sri Lanka is exporting all our minerals without any value addition. That story after 20 years is the same. It has not changed. I know many scientists attempted to make the change on this area, but still we do not do any value addition. And we are one of the countries that does not produce a single chemicals within the country. We import all our chemical needs. So this message stuck to my mind, and then I thought it's a very timely area to be explored. There were many attempts in the history to make a change in these industries, in particular graphite, magnetite, apatite, and ilmenite. So my story began again with apatite. You know, Eppavala has one of the best rock phosphate deposits, and we only use it for internal consumption. A very little amount is used. Rest is just sitting there. But we have an opportunity there because Eppavala apatite is one of the best deposits in the world with the minimum quantity of heavy metals. So if we can make apatite-based fertilizers, as I said in my previous slides, for my agriculture innovations, we use apatite nanoparticles. As an extension to the same projects, we did apatite nanoparticle formation with a very green chemistry approach, and two patents have been already granted for this innovation. And we have been able to make nanohydroxyapatite, which is soluble, which has a solubility similar to triple superphosphate or single superphosphate. So you don't have to do the mineral acid dissolution. You know, in globally, the phosphorus is added to the soil with acid dissolved product. So specifically dissolved in phosphoric acid or sulfuric acid. But here we do not use any of those acids. We use a very specific solution-assisted mechanochemical approach to make these particles, and we were able to come up with a new system. So that system is under negotiation with the third-party commercialization arm. And so the next important project that I would like to highlight is the titanium value addition to ilmenite and rutile. If you go to the eastern beach of Sri Lanka, you will see a black sand, which is as valuable as gold. I would say it's black gold. So it is so valuable. But Sri Lanka, for the last, when I first saw this story, it was, I think, 2005. We were selling this at 100 rupees a kilo, 80,000 metric tons each year. And the numbers have not changed. Yet we are sending 80,000 metric tons of rutile and ilmenite without any value addition. We just backhoe the sand from the eastern coast and send it out. Story is similar with graphite. Minimum value addition. We just take the world best graphite we have and we just send it out. No value addition. So if you look at the numbers, ilmenite sand and rutile sand, a metric ton is sold at USD 150 to 200. And if you make titanium dioxide from this, the numbers become USD 1,400 to 23,000. So you can see the magnification, right? And not stopping there, the topmost important product is titanium metal. That's the most valuable, one of the most valuable metals in the world. You know, bone implants and aerospace applications, titanium is very widely used. But unfortunately, to make titanium, globally there are only two methods, that is Hunter's method and the second one is FCC Cambridge method. Kroll method or Hunter's method, both use the same technology. You know, they use magnesium or sodium, molten magnesium or sodium, and then extract the titanium metal. Because it's very difficult to take this titanium metal out of the structure because of its rigidity. It's very strongly bound to the oxygen atoms. So taking this out needs a lot of energy. So we have developed a new method where this became actually maybe the third method which can be scalable. So we have also scaled up the process where we do a very specific vapor phase transportation method. So we use a vapor phase transportation method of magnesium to obtain titanium metal from titanium dioxide. And actually we were able to, so this is, if you look at our characterization, we were able to get the 99.37 pure titanium metal, and all characterization techniques confirmed the formation of titanium metal, which was again a very significant achievement by my team. And actually, we were able to secure again two US patents for this new innovation. So this we are really proud to own these two technology, because you can see we embarked onto a very virgin area of research here, because the area was not very crowded, so it was easy. But the team thought out of the box. That's the very important message I want to send, because without thinking out of the box, it's very difficult to come up with an innovation. So innovation bricks are always based on the out of the box thinking, but with very simple fundamentals. Your innovations have to be always simple and scalable. So this is about getting titanium. Not only that, we were able to develop in-house titanium dioxide extraction process, and actually we scaled up, but due to various economical reasons, due to various problems existing in this country, we couldn't take that project forward, but it is sitting there, and it is, I think, high time to come up with the entire process where we convert ilmenite rutile to titanium dioxide and finally to titanium metal. So this is an avenue that needs the young blood. We need your support, the young scientists. Not only that, we need the investments, we need the commercialization norms, and we need the capability for scale up. So all these factors have to align to make a success story. So only a scientist cannot make a dream true. All these factors should be aligned. Not only that, as I said, for the last 25 years, I have been collaborating with Peradeniya University Chemistry, although I'm attached to the University of Sri Jayawardenepura. So with Professor Chandani, from my first day of an undergraduate researcher until today, I am working with her. So this is one of the major projects that we have delivered together. chemistry para deniya. I think it's a significant milestone again. Chemistry para deniya to give the with chemistry Jawadhanapura. So here we attempted to develop a solution for water related problems, specifically hardness, fluoride, heavy metal, and desalination. So you know, water is a major or water is a hot topic today. So soon the world will run out of potable water and also industrial water. So at that time we need solutions specifically for desalination, alternatives for reverse osmosis. Here actually we were able to convert a coconut coir, a piece of coconut coir, to a very specific nanoporous material which is functionalized, which is very specifically, selectively functionalized to attract these different types of cations. And this particular project initiated in the physical laboratory at Peradeniya. And then if I remember, yes. And then now it is at a most developed project where we have a private-public partnership today. The private partner has already invested. Here we are trying to give a solution not for a mass scale filtration units, but we try to develop tea bag type filter material. So it is like you have pick clean water anywhere, the tea bag, you just have to put in the bottle, shake it for a while, keep it for 10 to 20 minutes, and then you are left with clean drinking water. So the actually the scaling up is still underway, but the laboratory level trials and the real water sample analysis in Anuradhapura and Polonnaruwa area is already completed. And we are quite happy. The two departments together did this work. And I'm actually glad. I'm still with my undergraduate supervisor. She is still behind my success. And this is one outcome. Actually, this I only discussed about three topics, three significant works that I have already delivered. There are more projects going on, but this is the team behind the same. My collaborators, my mentors, and especially I would also like to remind Prosenidra Karunaratna, who is one of the highest cited women scientists in Sri Lanka. So she also helped us a lot in this work. And these young minds, like you all, started their career with us. So these are the bricks of innovation. Each of these person in this photo came up with one brick. So to build this lost paradise. So they tried to align the bricks together to build the paradise. And I'm really, really thankful to this team, because they are today at very high levels. Some have completed their PhDs, returned to Sri Lanka and joined the staff, and some are very celebrated scientists in this team. And the current team you can see on your right hand side, they are working equally hard to write this story, to connect these bricks together. And now, all of those students in that picture, they realized their dreams, I guess. But to become a proud owner of a dream, it's not an easy journey. You can't just do anything overnight. It takes time. To do, first important message is that you have to select something that you love to do. You have to love what you do. Otherwise you can't do. And the neuroscientists or psychologists, they say that if you spend 10,000 hours on a particular area of work, you can reach to an outstanding level, global. You can meet the global standards. So I never thought it's true, but when I look at my career, it's been 12 years. I think my team actually have delivered. I mean, we are no second to any global science. There is nothing called local science. We are meeting the global standards. Now, this 10,000 hours, dear researchers, it is just 2.7 hours a day. If you work for 10 years, you can realize your dream. But you have to work. That's not a big number, isn't it? Just 2.7 hours a day. So it's very important that you have to avoid any pseudoscience. Everywhere you can see pseudoscience, right? So recently you would have seen this with the COVID-related innovations. Lancet withdrew one paper because of the pseudoscience. So there are no shortcuts. Please avoid pseudoscience. You have to do. I mean, it's actually not the time. It you may do something quickly, but you have to do. You have to follow the rules. You have to follow the pathway. Right. So with you shouldn't go for any quick wins. And science is global and serendipity. So you know. Serendipity is an important word. It's a take-home message for you. You will meet various serendipity events on your journey. Don't miss them. You might miss them if you don't think out of the box. It's very important that you think out of the box to find out these serendipity events. Many high class or high grade innovations are serendipity events, and it's very important that you think out of the box. So if you look at the ocean, there are two oceans. One is the red ocean, the other one is the blue ocean. Everybody or majority of the people are fighting in the red ocean. It's very crowded. Don't try to jump into your left hand side. The right hand side is empty. You have enough space to work with. So try to get into the blue ocean and realize your dream. That is very important. So with this little note of messages, I would like to conclude my talk today. But remember, work is not your life. You have to balance. We know there may be a lot of women scientists here. So I learned this from actually working a long time with Prof. Chandani. A woman has a lot of challenges. So we have to face it with the balance. In my journey, I cannot forget my husband, Sanjeeva, and my son, Netupa, who have always been very patient with me. And it's not easy to live with the mom like me, who is always making orders and making scientific claims at home, maybe. But we balance the life very, very well. And I always keep my time. I have a spare time always. Don't forget, you need your own time as well. Right? So don't forget that. And I would also like to thank my parents who have been behind me up today. Still they are supporting my journey, and also my team again, who has always been with me, and the University of Sri Jayawardenepura, who has always facilitated my journey. Again, to stop my talk today, the nation which does not create new things will not rise, and let's make the nation proud by Made in Sri Lanka, the quality label. Thank you very much for your attention. And thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Good night.
Thank you very much, Professor Kottegoda, for that inspirational talk and for opening our eyes to look at the big picture and reclaim and rebuild the nation with our capabilities. Now I would like to take any questions or comments from the audience. you can unmute yourselves and ask your question directly from Professor Kotegode, or you can use the raise hand option or type it in the chat.
Okay, Professor Nilwala, this is Ratnayaka Bandara. It's truly inspiring, your lecture, and we are very proud that you have, you know, gone there and you have contributed so much to the country, and we wish you all the best. Thank you very much for giving this inspiring lecture.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thanks.
Can I say something, Nilwala? I think your work on titanium is really encouraging, and this is the way to go. I mean, you know about my struggles writing letters to newspapers about value addition to minerals. I hope that in future you and your group will achieve something along these lines.
Actually, sir, your struggle motivated us to take it into the next state.
Okay.
So right. Thank you for initiating that important dialogue during my undergraduate career, actually.
Thank you, Nilwala, and an excellent presentation, especially for the younger scientists to get themselves motivated and focused for a better career in their future. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Do we have any other comments or questions for Professor Nilwala from the audience? Until we get a question, I would like to ask Professor Kotegode a small question. So you mentioned that you had to go through a lot of hardships during the first part of your career upon returning back to Sri Lanka. So I want to know what motivated you and not to give up, but to go on during that time.
Actually, there were a lot of instances where I felt that I should go back. But again, the courage in me, hidden scientist in me, the iron nature. So actually, I felt that I shouldn't give up. I am going to realize my dream somehow. And then on all those occasions, I had a team of mentors who encouraged me, and then I thought my supervisor has always given me the example not to give up. So I actually developed the same gene in me as well. I think now I think I am not going to give up anything that I start.
Thank you, Professor Nilwala. That was very inspiring. I would like to ask the audience if they have any questions. Students, do you have any questions for Professor Nilwala? You can also type it in the chat. Yes.
I have just a brief comment, not on the chemistry side, but on what you said, your iron lady. I know that you have been driving from Horana with a little baby to come to work at Peradeniya, driving along all that way, which shows your dedication to teaching and, of course, the departmental work at that time. So this is just a personal thing I am aware of. I have talked to you about that several times. And when to make a decision for the sake of the family. So anyway, this shows the iron lady in Nilwala.
Thank you for the clarification, sir. Yes, I drove daily from Horana to Peradeniya for 2 years.
Thank you, sir. students. Do we have any questions or like staff too, if you want to add something? This is the time. You can mention your questions or comments in the chat too, so I can read it out. Okay, until we get another question, I have another question for Professor Kottigore. So I would like to know, how big is your research group? You showed like a big picture. So I it seems like it's quite a lot of people working with you in the team.
Currently, I have about 12 students. So with we have about I supervise about 5 PhDs, 3 MPhils, and about 5 undergrads. Yeah, 12 to 13 students in my group right now, and I suppose some of the Peradeniya students with Professor Chandani too.
Okay, madam. Thank you for that. I think we have some comments in the chat. One person says the session was truly amazing. The way you presented was very interesting, felt so motivated. I wish you good luck with all your work. Thank you very much. And you look so beautiful. And another person said, thank you very much for inspiring and amazing presentation, madam.
Thank you.
You can type more comments or questions in the chat. I can take them. Another person says, very nice of you to acknowledge the role played by Professor Gamini Rajapaksha.
Thank you.
Another comment for you, madam. Dear madam, it is really inspirational presentation. Thank you. Since we've taken all the questions and comments and time's up also, I would like to give over to Dilki to speak a few words. Over to you, Dilki.
Thank you, madam. Good evening, everyone. I consider it a great honor and privilege to propose the word of thanks this evening on behalf of the Department of Chemistry, University of Peradeniya, and members of the INSPIRE team. To begin with, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Professor Nilbala Kottigoda for spending her valuable time with us amidst her busy schedules to share her precious knowledge and expertise with us today. Thank you, madam, for that captivating insight into bricks of innovations to rebuild the lost paradise. We found this webinar to be very informative, motivating, and an excellent guidance for young scientists and young generation who are interested in innovations in the field of science in order to contribute their talents to this nation and for the world. I'm sure you inspired many students who are present here today. Next, I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to Professor Chandani Pereira for inviting Professor Nilbala Kottigoda to the INSPIRE stage and hosting her today. Thank you, madam, for your motivation and dearest support. We are always sincerely grateful to Professor Manavadevi Gane Henage, head of the Department of Chemistry, for her encouragement, constant guidance, and support throughout to make the entire INSPIRE webinar series a success. And finally, yet importantly, I would like to thank all of you who have joined with us today via Zoom and hope you found this evening very valuable and fruitful as much as we did. Before winding up today's session, I would like to invite you all to our 10th INSPIRE webinar on the 14th of October at 5 p.m. And the invited speaker is Professor Sandeep Verma, Professor at the Department of Chemistry and Nanoscience at Indian Institute of Technology at Kanpur. And he will be speaking about peptide-based palette in chemical neuroscience, stem cell engineering, and applied coloration. Thank you. Have a pleasant evening. Thank you.